work on the 2018 marketing plan and provide feedback to staff regarding that plan. So I'm going to turn it over to Sherry.
Good morning. We have before you a draft of our working document for the FY 2018 marketing plan, and then in addition to our current fiscal year approved marketing plan to use as a reference. The staff has gone through the marketing plan and made some adjustments. However, all of the market segments will remain the same. We do need, of course, board input on our benchmarks. We're looking at where we've been and where we're going and getting input from the each of the board members on that. And then, of course, now that we have our committees in place and how that's all going to flow together. So we want to just jump right in and go through each of the segments.
Sure.
Okay. So the first segment we'll look at, of course, is our visitor center. I forgot that, didn't I?
The back of the first page.
And again, this would be page 3 on your draft. And we've updated the objectives. Are there any comments, suggestions for the information that's there?
Benchmarks might we be looking at, Sherry?
Well, if we look at what we did for this current year, as we know, we're kind of starting with ground zero. So what we want to be able to do this year is to be able to have more concrete numbers. You know, last year, or this current year that we're in, we have percentages. We do have some better data now to where we could, again, depending on what the board wants to set as, you know, our benchmarks for this next year. I'll use the visitor center for an example. You know, we had a 10% increase in visitors to the visitor center. Well, currently, right now, year to date, we've had a 20% increase in visitors to our visitor center. So, I believe we've had, what, 7,400 people come into the visitor center at this point. So, again, if we want to set, you know, our goal to be, we want to have, you know, 20,000 people, for instance, come to the visitor center this next year and what that percent of increase would be.
To me, that could be driven by a number of factors. So that could be, maybe the website's bringing them in. Maybe other things are bringing them in. I think, to me, the most important objective would be focused on that last bullet, collect data for visitor tracking and future marketing efforts. If we have those data, if there's a way to figure out if people who come to the visitor center are coming back to Macatoches, mm-hmm. to me, that would be the most important metric.
I think the other important factor is conversion. If they're hitting the website, are they actually coming? And if they're coming, are they staying? So, to me, we have to make some of those assumptions, but I think they're at least more definitive than where we came from. That's what we're talking about. We had a great place last year in being able to set some of these. I mean, we had nowhere to go but up. So, I think our first year was more of a reactionary. We had to get something down, but now we can actually state what we believe. So, I think those factors you're talking about are the things that need to be in writing. That's what we should in the event of, or should be based upon, you know, but we have to start somewhere in being what she wants. Now, another thing that we found, not to interject, but, and you guys may or may not be aware of it, but the last report that Melissa did was an annual report.
Was a what?
Was an annual report.
Oh.
And so what she did is she kind of took the whole year and reported on that and what was to be, and then pretty well decided what was going to come next. So I'm wondering if what Shelley is used to is that. If she was used to seeing something that had those definitive numbers.
I don't know. But if we've got objectives that say we're going to strengthen return visits and build brand awareness, we have to measure that.
Yep.
Right.
I see that.
Well, we are in the process of that now with our new electronic sign-in and other sign-ins, which has more requests for data than we've ever had before. How did you find out about us? You know, blah blah blah.
Well, that's one of the factors. We've changed how we collect data and what data we collect. So you can't accurately compare it to what we've done in the past until that rolls in over a year period, right? So that, I think that's part of the challenge of the reporting side of it, is that it's not comparative data, it's some new information we didn't collect before.
Right, so I think the benchmarks probably, rather than documenting that we're strengthening returning visits and building brand awareness, the benchmark for this first year should be, what are we doing with those data to try to meet those objectives?
Right. The data collection and where it goes from there, and what
we plan to do with it.
Why would you? What we've changed in data collection and why? It's to get more accurate information on the guests who are visiting us to determine whether they are returned, where they're coming from, as far as through the website or how they're getting to us. Are they returning, and do they plan on returning? So then we can retarget our marketing efforts towards that. If it's mostly web, mostly print ad here, then we can react to that.
Doesn't the survey, follow-up survey, cover all that too?
If it doesn't cover it all, it should. Because to me, that's how we're going to get our benchmarks.
Yeah.
That would be exactly how the question should be approached.
Yeah. And right now the questions are... of course, geared toward the visitor center, with the exhibits. And of course, you took a survey, but the exhibits and the information that's available here. Mm-hmm. And, people said whether they were very satisfied or not as satisfied, how much they learned, about the history while they were here.
I thought it also asked, though, how did you hear about it? Did it ask how many days you're staying?
It does. It asks, how did you hear about us?
Mm-hmm.
And how many people were at the party? Did you stay overnight?
Yeah.
And then
will you come back?
And then what time frame? Within the year? Within a couple of years? So it did survey.
So you were going to put the measures of success on this one. You just hadn't done it yet.
No. The measure of success are now going to become benchmarks.
Okay.
I feel we've graduated.
Okay.
But that's it. So in order to create the benchmarks, we need to just look back at the objectives and address those, right, on how we're going to accomplish the objectives.
How are you going to measure whether we are accomplishing those or not?
And let me just say, aesthetically, because you guys are all into the, how we're going to make a benchmark. That's great. But let me review it. When you get a good draft, if this is the draft, that's great. Let me review it and change some of the wording. Sometimes we have a tendency to be too wordy. You know what I mean? It's like somebody got a thesaurus out and, started trading a bunch of different words. And I think it'd be better if it were simpler. Like, instead of to be the point of convergence, I don't know. It can just be better. It can be better in a touchy-feely sense,
So you're talking about the plan itself?
I'm just talking about the writing.
Okay.
And I'll make suggestions.
Because I was going to, and this might be jumping around a little bit, but for the visitor center itself, I thought you were going to talk about the... I know that a lot of improvements were made this last year with the digital monitor. I assume we're using that as well as we can. Maybe we can, you guys have ideas on that. Like the electrical outlets, both that, but the other things that made it more appealing during the Christmas season, the holiday season, that was done. I was wondering, it doesn't seem like we need to improve much more with technological advances, but can we capitalize on what we've done this year in other ways? The backdrops, we added in those, more of those.
Right, but and that all comes in as part of the quarterly reporting, probably, not a marketing plan.
Okay.
Or a summation. If you did it in an annual report, you would do it that way.
Right.
You don't do it in your report?
No, it's just a marketing plan now.
No, I know, but you do an annual report, right?
Quarterly report.
Quarterly reports.
Okay.
But the successes of where we came from are not in here. And the only way that they would be included if we were to do some sort of summation.
This is not the place for that.
Yeah.
No, I agree, but there does need to, gosh, at some point, she needs to be able to see what you accomplished
absolutely
in the year all at one time.
Who is she?
Mayor.
Brophy. Oh. We're talking about Brophy.
But that'll be at the quarterly report.
Yeah.
That'll be done.
Well, what we need to do here is to have a marketing plan that has very distinct objectives for each of our segments. Measurable objectives. With ways that we can measure whether or not we're meeting them. It's that simple. And so, if we're going to say that our visitor center is going to enhance services, how are we going to measure that? Well, that's a survey. Right? If we're going to strengthen return visits, then our benchmarks for this first year is we're going to collect data. Right? To find out if, in fact, we're going to meet that objective. Are these people coming back? Somewhere down the road. We're going to build brand awareness and drive more visits. Okay, how are we going to measure that? We have to have measurable objectives. Continue to sell Nacogdoches merchandise. I don't think that's a measurable objective. Well, I guess it can be. It's just sales figures.
Yeah. Inventory.
I don't think maintaining existing displays, frankly, is an objective. Unless you can document how it's enhancing the visitor experience. Maybe that's a survey thing too, right?
Do you feel like the last one, objective, would be more of a...
I think that's an overarching kind of... I think that's one of our benchmarks, right?
Yeah, that's a benchmark. Yeah,
for this first time through.
Okay.
Because until we have those data, we can't really measure anything else. And I'm not sure how you say it be the point of convergence, ain't something.
Well, you say you touch a feely up a little bit. You know, we are the heart of the, you know, the beating heart of
information.
Visitors.
Visitors,
no, I don't want to see beating heart anywhere in this thing.
Okay.
But I agree, Tracy, with that word choice. I mean, basically, we're the source of information for visitors.
Okay. But you'll work on it. You'll send us your suggestions.
I can.
Reporting. Okay.
No beating hearts. Okay.
How about leading hearts?
Yeah, BLEATING. We're going to go all sheet money.
Maybe.
All right, what's next?
Okay, so you mentioned moving the collect data for this for tracking and future marketing efforts down to a benchmark.
I think that has to be.
Yeah, because that's what we're going to do to measure.
Because I think that's all, at this point, that's what we're really going to do is to collect data to see if, in fact, those data show that we are doing these other things.
And then we have to define how we're getting the data.
That makes sense?
Sure. Do you get a good response to the surveys?
Huh?
Yes, good.
They're complete.
is with that we're, again, we just started this. So as we get more and more people coming in, signing in, giving us that email information, then we'll get more and more input from those people, which will give us a lot more ability to really have concrete data.
Just a, throwing this out, and I don't want to take a whole lot of time on it, but sometimes while I've been here, I know even though we encourage them to go to that, some prefer just to go to the book and sign in.
It's still a form, though, where they can fill out it more than it
can. Okay.
Yeah. We have both.
It's the same form that they would do.
Because I just see them over there with their pen, yeah, and they move on.
Yeah,
and
they get
I don't think they're giving all that could be gathered.
Yeah, they, and on when they're doing that electronic sign-in, they're is quite a bit of information. Like if you look at the reports, mm-hmm, there's a large number that's like blank. You don't know what it is because they're not answering that question.
Okay.
Because they're not required. So not every field is required on that visitor sign-in.
I guess what I'm saying is there a way that we can make sure that the people that prefer to write give the same information that, I mean, is that being used?
The form is the same.
Okay, that's all I want.
The form is the same as the electronic sign-in.
Okay.
Whether they're handwriting it or they're typing it in.
Good, yeah.
And then our interns are going,
putting in, and inputting that into the system.
There we go, great.
For somebody who doesn't text well, like me, like one big fat finger, that electronic sign-in thing is too small.
Yeah.
It would frustrate me.
That's why we have paper for you.
Can you read his handwriting?
Okay. Yeah, and I think that's probably one of our challenges with getting data is, again, you know, some information is required and some is not, so we're leaving it up to them to share that information with us, and some do and some don't. So that's the,
you know,
the challenge there is just going on the data that is provided to us. So.
Well, let's think about if there's a better way. Maybe all we really need from them is an email address, and then it's the follow-up where we get more information.
On the sign-in machine, and you require the email.
If you require them to put an email address down, you're going to find that you're getting into a privacy issue. These people may want to give it to you, they may not, whereas you're going to lose other valuable data, such as how they found out about us, how many people are coming, blah, blah, blah. There may be a way to get them to do it voluntarily, but I don't know that you want to try to make it a required.
My suggestion would be as simple as just putting your name in your email, and then all of those follow-up.
Everything else comes from follow-up, yes.
Will come in the survey. It's not that we're losing them. If they're not going to give us their email.
No, right? It's just a lot quicker and easier for them to do it when they're
instead of doing that laundry list over there.
Because we can follow up with an email survey just as easy as anything else.
I think you'd get better response there because oftentimes when people are walking in the door, you know, it's the first time they've ever been in the door.
They don't want to spend 10 minutes.
They don't want to take time to do a survey. You know?
But if we get an email address, then they can do the survey when they're sitting at home after they get
it. Yeah, it's easy to get, I think, the email.
Then the screen doesn't become so small. You just have a name.
All you need is a name and an email.
And
address.
An email.
And zip code. It's just
I'm just not a big fan of surveys. I don't think anybody with any normal life fills out a survey. I mean,
surveys are the way marketing turns. I mean, it just is what it is.
I mean, and then you have to factor in who has the time to give a survey. And then whatever your survey results are, it's going to be skewed to whatever type of person fills out a survey, you know, which I would guess is going to be old people.
Now, Lisa, if we kept your email, you can market to the people. They were already in our door. They were already here.
Name, email, zip code. Everything else can be follow-up.
If you can get their email, then you can...
That's a qualified customer.
Yeah.
Right there.
Yeah.
It's just the way of the world. And, you know, the thing is, I know maybe old people, but in order to keep things rolling, we got to address the younger generation. I mean, they're the future.
Yeah.
I heard that in a song somewhere.
You did. Well, I'll sing it.
Right.
You know, the way you get them to take your surveys is you somehow provide an incentive for doing so.
You know, they get, keep it short. Sweet.
They get something for it.
Right. Let's move to leisure.
Okay. Wait a minute. So what happened in the visitor center section? They're supposed to flesh out how they're going to track things and then remove...
We're going to make sure that we have measurable objectives, and those objectives are going to be measured by the data that we're going to collect over the next year.
Okay.
And that becomes our measure. Big picture, that's the one piece of advice that I want to provide today, is we have to have measurable objectives, period.
Because I feel sorry for you guys with...
And maybe that means fewer objectives.
Coming up with a way to make it a little bit longer, because if we're taking stuff out of here, she's going to be like, this isn't long enough, you know. I mean,
well, we're not building this for one person, number one, all right?
Right.
Well,
this is a marketing plan for this operation.
If we need fewer objectives that
we know we can measure well, then we need fewer objectives that we know we can measure well.
It is.
More objectives is not the key.
We have to always remember that at the end of the game, it's like these stupid star tests. You know, they have to teach to the test to some extent.
We have a mission.
We have to realize that our audience that approves the budget for this place is a certain person and a certain group of people. We need to just keep that in mind.
We have a mission that is about increasing overnight stays and marketing Nacogdoches as a destination. That's the only mission we have.
Didn't we come up with this because the first one was too long?
Yes, exactly.
And that was the word from
all of them.
The entity that we had too much, and they wanted an itinerary kind of just an outline with bullet points and such. Is that how we came up with this, right? If I remember correctly.
And that's fine.
And if we need to
fill, and we may even tighten it up further. But here again, as long as we have specific measurable objectives and documented ways that we're going to say, yes, we met these, or no, we did not, then we're fine.
Yeah, and it's got to be the truth. I mean,
right, it's got to be a viable document.
Yeah, we've got two people here. And yeah, you're going to throw a bunch of money if you're not going to be sure. But if you turn to the next ones, I mean, you know, now you're talking about the segments of where we got to really make an impact. I mean, to me, the visitor center is the tangible.
All right. So let's make sure here that we've got measurable. Develop partnerships as part of our integrated marketing campaign that attracts target niche markets. Okay. So what part of that is going to be, I mean, what part of that is our objective? Developing partnership or attracting targeted niche markets?
I think it's the partnership, but that's just my opinion.
But developing partnerships in and of itself doesn't mean anything.
No, it doesn't. Unless we were to define who the partnerships were with.
And why. And what the point is.
Well, the point is because we have to have a niche market. Partnerships would be wine, whiskey, and brew. So the partnerships would be to develop those relationships with those three entities here in town that attract people that like to taste.
That's just one leisure market, though.
Yeah,
you're giving
one.
An example.
I'm giving an example.
I mean, we have our nature. We have our
music,
yeah, entertainment, fine arts.
So how are we defining partnerships? Because if you're going to measure this objective, I'm saying, okay, how many partnerships did you develop?
Right.
What does that mean?
Well, I know what it means, but what I'm wondering
we have to be able to measure it.
Yeah, in numbers, right?
Well, okay, so you say you developed 9 partnerships. My next question is, what does that mean?
I think we'd have to identify the industries and the people that represent them here in our community. And I go countywide.
So it's community partnerships. That we're
so developing. Partnerships meaning that they've signed something with us? Partnerships meaning we've talked to them X number of times? What does it mean?
Partnerships that they're using the new website resources.
Okay, maybe that's the measure, that they're using the extranet.
Yeah, which is what they're doing.
Okay, now that's a tangible, measurable thing. And so if we put that piece in there as part of our measurement, then we've got a tangible objective.
I'm not sure, and I apologize if I haven't done my research on the new website, but I go back to the travel text. You know, I can go, I like to hike and canoe, you know. I mean, do we have those different...
At the same time.
In Texas, and it tells me where I can do that.
Like,
I'm just saying, do we have those identified, those little market niches identified? Because I'm thinking leisure's where that happens, you know. And is there a way a visitor on our website can say, I like to eat food and drink homebrew?
Isn't there? Yeah.
It sparks like doing this. And the reason why I'm asking this is just, to me, that would be measurable, because we're going to know how many people are clicking on what, so we would know if they're using it. That would be another way to measure.
But we know what pages they're going to.
Yeah.
There's got to be another measure, though, other than the using extranet, to me.
Well, here again, look at that first bullet point. What is your objective? Is it to develop partnerships or to attract niche markets? Because you're going to have different measures if for one versus the other.
So we could do both. We could have them using the extranet for the partnership, and we could attract the target niche markets by
tracking the clicks.
The clicks, yeah.
Consistent public relations initiatives continue to build brand awareness. Okay. How are we going to measure that?
I think that would be proof in the stories that we get written about, the blogging and all that stuff.
Okay. So how are you going to develop a measure? So what's enough? What defines success versus failure if you're going to measure this through how many times were mentioned in blogs and things like that?
Can we pick a number?
You have to pick a number.
Yeah, we have to.
But it has to make sense at some level.
To me, I mean, I'm a seasonal girl. I would define it by quarters and then how many we want. I mean, that's just me. I don't know if we don't. I mean, we obviously got a whole lot this last spring, even though we missed the azalea. But the stories weren't on the azaleas. They're about being this, you know, top 10 small town.
Story about
azaleas, and then we got the favorite food festival.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we get a variety of them.
Yeah.
I mean, I could say a minimum of four, just if we were spreading them out through the course of the year, but it could always be more.
As far as your public relations goes, if you look at that story that we had that we put onto our Facebook page, we got over 40,000 hits on it, so you can. There are some ways from the digital standpoint to be able to track some of those public relations, as well as over 200 shares on that. So, from the standpoint of public relations, one of the ways is number of people wanting more information on the destination.
Yeah, and that's all valid, but you got to have a number.
Still got to have a number, and that's fine. We'll come up with a number.
You can come up with a number.
Yeah. This is dump stock, so.
And you also have to have a beginning number, I guess, too, that's going to be measured if you're measuring where you're coming from. Because I can see that being whenever you're measuring something, it's or the growth of something, you have to have a benchmark of where you were.
I would say
We're kind of starting from zero.
We are. I mean, we have, and we for what has been done already this fiscal year, how many stories we at least have that gives us kind of the first 6 months.
Well, we have analytics on like our Facebook page. That's been up for a long time, right? And so you know the stories is you know, being viewed X number of times. As in, where does that story place? Is it that's the best story we've ever, the most hits we've ever gotten on front? Well, that's clearly that we garnered a lot more interest. So you know, that's a measurable thing. So that's something that you have to know.
Take off. Thank you, guys.
Well, I was just about to ask, though, would the public relations area also include, like, when the Tree City folks did their presentation at the Miller's Crossing facility? Is that part of public relations? Does that constitute story or focus on Nacogdoches, or is that going to be somewhere else in the plan? Because some of these groups and organizations are identifying Nacogdoches as a place to come to hold. I guess that would be conventions and meetings.
Well, there's different, like the Azalea visitors and such like that. They come in on buses. That's leisure, right? It doesn't really fall into that. And some of this stuff does have some crossover.
Absolutely,
you know.
Yeah.
Some visitors who come here for one purpose might see another purpose to come back, and there have been examples of that before. Right? There was a group who came through, I think it was a dentist actually that was saying, you know, wow, yeah, I haven't been here in a while. They used to do a local circuit of an East Texas dentist or something. But anyway, it has. These aren't exclusive to their segment, I think, in many cases, and that's what makes it good that we cross over into
and you'll see that in some of the objectives. They're the same in some of them. But the reason why I made this is an easier way to see it. Like, this is our committees versus our visitors that are on there. But one of the ways where we identify, and one of the things we were talking about yesterday on groups, because sometimes a group could be from a convention and where they want to go out and do something fun and leisure-like, especially for example, the spouses and stuff. But then you've got leisure that come in through cars and maybe even an event that we haven't been able to capture. But now that we've got these... we have the CDB links to some of our hotels. So if they use that link off of our website that's provided, then it's a way for us to count. Even though it might be onesie twosies, it's still business that we haven't been before able to capture. And then I look at groups as something that's on a bus, something that's whether it's a day trip or an overnight. Your mystery tours, they're still coming here for leisure, but we have two definitive groups under that, and it entails getting a bunch of people and putting them somewhere or bringing them somewhere. I may be wrong, but I just think for sanity, that seemed to make the most sense. And that's an area we want to grow. We're actually going to the Southwest, what are we going to?
Southwest Region Bus
Association. Right, that it is event planners on a bus versus a meeting planner. But they still are coordinating efforts to come here and do a lot of fun things.
Well, it looks to me like your group tours and your sports is really almost completely overlapping with leisure.
Yes.
To a great extent. So I think what makes sense to me is to trim the leisure piece down.
So it's leisure chief, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it sure is.
But, you know, you look at that third bullet point, focus on that's not an objective, that's a strategy. Focus on 3 to 5 hour drive market. Okay, that's a strategy to build leisure tourism, but that's not the measurable objective, nor should it be. Leverage added value benefits by establishing and maintaining media relations. Tell me exactly what that means.
That would be like, of course, one example I can think of is when we worked with, of course, it's meeting related, but Connect Texas, when Joanna went to that show, meeting planners, but we participated in the Texas Meeting Planner Guide. We did an ad. But through that, we also had an opportunity to get some added value editorial in that as well. So, that's what I think of.
When that also, when you also consider that maintaining media relationships, like with some of our fam trip type things, where we get to one-on-one with these people. Mm-hmm. I mean, to me, that's establishing media relationships right there is our fam trip. So
I think what we want to avoid is building objectives that we know we can probably have data to support.
Absolutely.
All right. Right. Let's build objectives that we know we want to try to achieve rather than, okay, how can we word an objective to say that we went to this convention and did this? Right? I think we've got too many objectives.
So we're going to take out the strategy of number 3.
I mean, when it comes to this leisure segment, if you're not talking about group tours, you're not talking about sports, who exactly are we talking about, right? We're talking about folks coming in for a weekend of music, or folks coming in just to, because it's the oldest town in Texas, and they want to see what it looks like, right?
More transient leisure.
Very much so.
Right, instead of group leisure.
I mean, planned.
Yeah.
Planned stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so and it's an important segment. But what do we want to accomplish with those people, and how are we going to measure it? I think the niche marketing thing, I think those specialty kinds of weekend events are golden for us. If we can manage to get people to come here for a Friday and Saturday night instead of just driving in on Saturday and leaving Saturday afternoon. Right? That's great. But then our objective should be to do that, to extend leisure stays beyond a single day. And then how are we going to measure whether we're accomplishing that?
Well, to me, that kind of gets into, the first bullet where we talked about partnerships and just using Blueberry Festival for an example. Of course, that's using extranet too, but working with the chamber and local businesses to do offers that we're promoting on the side with the landing page and so forth. And yes, we can track how many people are coming to that specific landing page. We would know how many partners we have, but anyway, so.
Yeah, I think
that. And we're going into starting with Thursday and, making a full weekend, building out around the Saturday.
Sure. And then ultimately the measure becomes how many more room nights are we getting and how much more odd tax are we generating?
Yeah.
Right? Down the road, that's our measure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what about number 4? Are we going to put this fam tour stuff? Do we want to define familiarization tours under leisure?
But I think what we're saying is that's not an objective, right?
Well, number 3 was an objective.
I know, but we're kind of putting things in the objectives that are...
I'm asking, do we get rid of it?
Yeah.
Leverage added value benefits by establishing and maintaining media relations. Okay, so when I look at that, then the measure to me has to be, okay, are you establishing and maintaining media relations? And if so, why? Right? It's the same way with developed partnerships. If we're developing partnerships and we're going to document partnerships, there's got to be a reason to do it. Developing and or establishing and maintaining media relations, doesn't that go back to this brand awareness thing in bullet number 2?
Yep, it does.
So maybe there's a way to put those two together. And then I think your last bullet is a strategy rather than an objective, too.
Which one?
The last relevant one. Incentives.
And that can be easily measured because you know what you're developing, the things, the benefits you can offer them.
Yeah, that comes into packages, that comes into discounts, that kind of, yeah, that is measurable, sure.
No, it's not.
You don't think so?
Nope.
It's a strategy. It's a strategy.
Yes.
But we can document how we're doing it or what's been done that supports.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's not an objective.
And it's not only.
Overall, the objective for this segment is
1 and 2.
Yeah.
Yep.
I can make a blanket statement that I'm very impressed and happy with the way the staff handles advertising, print, and digital publishing.
Through our local partnerships.
I think everyone does a good job. I mean, I
missed what happened over here, but anyway.
Smart man. So anyway, those two strategies are going to go probably under either probably public relations.
Okay. Ready to move on?
Yeah, I think right now if we focus on objectives, we're going to
be absolutely narrow down the objectives and make sure we can measure our objectives.
And then we'll drill down from there.
Okay. So conventions and meetings. I think we're going to get into the same discussions we've already had on some of these that aren't.
That first one, I mean, the objective there really is to increase the total number of visitors and economic impact.
All right, we'll start with that.
Yeah, and you do that by these strategies.
Yes. So that's really the objective, is the last piece of that.
So number two is the strategy, and number one. Right?
Well, leverage partnerships with key community businesses, third-party players. I think of here again, the objective is to secure marketing sponsorships.
Okay.
All right. The first part of that is the strategy, but the objective is to secure marketing sponsorships. Initiatives about the region, providing accurate information impacting our ability to attract meetings. I'm not sure I get that.
That may become a strategy. We may move it down to a strategy as well. That's basically since we mentioned to oldest town in Texas, we want people to think, have them, that we're old and there's nothing to do here. You know, okay. Focusing on the new. And yes, we do have a lot of history, but focusing too on some of the new things.
Well, just like the Texas starts here, right? Well, how about the music starts here, the fun starts here. I mean, you can play off of that. Many cities do that on their logos, and I think we need to take advantage of something like that. That's a new, fun way to spin what we are, which is the oldest town in Texas. And that there is a place for that as well. And I don't know that it's in conventions and meetings,
right?
But it could be.
Could be.
Because of what Joanna was talking about earlier. You know, you bring 80 people to town with spouses and stuff, and, you know, they're not here just for the meeting.
Depends on the segment, too. Like what if it's an association, what association is it? It's the Historic Association of Texas. Well, that's probably right in that wheelhouse, you know. But you know, depending on what it is, the spouses are coming or the spouses are not. It depends on what you do. But then we talk on our webpage and such. If you have those links, let's say you're to the hiking and the all that kind of, you know, the outdoor stuff, the zip lining and such, or the Splash Kingdom, or then, you know, the historic sites or whatever, you have all those things set up, the agendas, if you will, for these groups, and you depend on what they are, you market right to them, or you give them the option and they choose what they want. But we've got to get that information out to them. You know, I think getting this new system that we have, I think it's going to be very helpful in sharing that message and getting it out to meeting planners. Trying and I talked the other day about, you know, I'm doing some of that kind of stuff myself, marketing to meeting planners specifically in this tri-state area, just to, you know, get back on the radar that we have a place.
And maybe that's really what this objective is
attract more
meetings. I mean, is the objective, but ultimately the measure then is going to be how many meeting planners. I mean, are we talking to how many meeting planners have we brought to town? How many meeting planners are?
I know there are several in the pipe that we're talking to now that are discussing with us because we put out there help with some of our old people that we're actively searching for this segment, you know, these.
Yeah.
This portion of people, this meetings and conventions and association.
Okay, so going back to what Sherry was saying, the objective here is to attract more meetings. But one of the strategies could be to provide accurate information about the resources that Nacogdoches can offer to these people.
Right. We have a lot more channels it's a lot easier to go through these channels now with this the system that we have, and with our revamped website, it's much easier to disperse this information.
And maybe that's how we measure some of this stuff. So essentially, our third objective is to attract more meetings, right? And that's certainly measurable. That fourth bullet, I don't think we want to have the Fredonia Hotel necessarily specified.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's uncomfortable for lots of reasons.
Right.
Maybe. I think what we need to do is highlight the resources available that make Nacogdoches an ideal location for meetings.
Our convention center or
facilities.
1,000-plus hotel rooms and convention center that will hold whatever you sleep.
Yeah, whatever it is.
Yeah.
But you can't measure highlight.
Yeah.
Okay. So if we're going to leave that thing in there, we've got to have a measurable objective.
We do have flexible venues.
We do.
We can accommodate 15 or 150 or about.
And that's what a meeting planner wants to see. They want to see we can do a meeting from, you know, to 10 to 1,000, and we have 1,100. I think we'll have, which is accurate, 1,100 hotel rooms. or 1,200, whatever that number is, when you add in bed and breakfast and our friends out, like at Stagley, you know, we add that kind of stuff in. On a snapshot, the meeting planner wants to be able to see, okay, they have 1,200 hotel rooms in this place and have different meeting.
I think Joanna's done a good job of defining that. I've seen some of her lists, depending on what the group's looking for.
Mm-hmm.
She's
That's
so nice.
Very blessed.
Hey, let me ask you something. Is one of the other things about is resources, is this where we would put transportation?
Definitely for meetings and groups.
Right, yeah. Because that's going to be important for a meeting planner or someone with an association. If we're going to have to place people at several different locations, they're going to want to know that we have some sort of transportation that we can help move these people.
So in the objective, when we're talking about highlight the resources available.
Well, I don't know that highlight is going to be measurable.
Okay, so
that would just become a strategy, right?
A measurable goal, could that be how many bids you actually put out?
Absolutely,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's actually, that you can measure other than, as well as attending conventions.
But. Yes.
See, I got an analytic. I sent out an email blast that hey, we're coming back open, we're coming online. And it was the 800 and something meeting planning.
Just well,
yeah. He practiced that all weekend.
The 400 of them opened the email, right?
There you go.
So I mean, that's of that 400. I think most of them did a secondary click once they opened the email.
There you go. So those kinds of things, you just come up with a number that makes sense in the industry. Yeah. So basically our objective is increase the total number of visitors and economic impact to the city, secure marketing sponsorships to further expose the destination to potential meeting customers, and attract more meetings.
Got it.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Check.
Segment says utilize CVB's advertising agency. Do we have an advertising agency?
Do we have one? We have a community partnership with an advertising
agency. There you go.
I'm shocked nobody's brought in stakeholders yet. Nobody said
stakeholders. Oh, I know.
I'm playing my bingo over here.
Oh, hey. Being from higher ed, I've got some really new interesting words for you.
Okay.
We had a strategic planning meetings last week.
Yeah.
Yes, we're onboarding new people.
There you go. Yeah. I'll be onboarding.
We're crosswalking ideas. We're crosswalking ideas.
Just got a vision of Abbey Road.
Crosswalking ideas.
Okay.
Man. Great. Okay, so if we're concentrating on objectives right now,
yep.
Then I think some of this other stuff can probably be streamlined a little bit as well. But let's make sure that we've got good, solid, measurable objectives.
Okay. Yeah, that's the foundation, right? That's the foundation.
Yeah, once you get that.
Yes.
Got it.
Okay, so we're looking at group tours. Now, when I think of group tours, I'm thinking of those day trippers out of Houston.
And I don't want to think about those.
Yeah.
I want it to be all about the overnight. Because here's the thing on the day trips. Like right now, with, for one, they don't spend enough money, and they don't spend the night, and they're not coming back. I mean,
our job
like
is to put them in hotels.
Right. And so, but we can include them under there.
but we have to find a way to. One of the things the system does not do right now is give us any kind of economic impact on day trips. And so until it does, I don't think it should be our focus.
No, I don't either. Okay. I think our focus should be turning those day trips into overnight trips.
Yes, of which we've been somewhat successful, but when you cater to, which has really been something that Millard's Crossing has taken on, is this Harris County day things. They do a day thing. And we've gotten a lot of business from it. But it's time to say
about that. But it's not CBB.
They can't because they have a limited amount of time on the bus.
Yeah. All right. So what are our objectives when it comes to these group tours?
We want them to spend the night.
Okay. So that should be one of our objectives, is to convert day trips into overnight trips. Right? Or to increase the number of overnight stays with group tours.
You know, if we can start talking to some of these tour companies that used to roll through here, or that have rerouted to different areas, that you know, we would be the mid stop on there.
That's the meeting we're going to. But another DMO that does a really good job of that is I want to say Amarillo. I don't know West Texas at all, but they actually talk about being that last stop to New Mexico, to Colorado.
Last stop to anywhere.
Yeah, we can do that too. You know, one of the other things I was talking to Sherry about, you know, we talk about a drive-through and people that are coming through and they have had that cluster from down south. You know, where's the sign that says we're the last stop? Because if you're heading up 59, there's nothing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think there's something there that could be useful to us, because if people think they're going to drive through, where are they going to stop?
Who takes these tours? How many of these operations are still around?
A lot. There's a lot of them.
Are there?
Yeah, and that's why we're going to that show.
But we have to have a hook for them to. They're going to divert from Waco or from wherever they're stopping now in mid-Texas.
We need to crosswalk some of our marketing ideas.
Yeah. Right. Well, exactly. That's what I'm talking about. I love that idea. I think it's just smart.
Mm-hmm. Right. Your typical example is the one we just had.
Yeah.
Is a 4-day trip, mystery tour, retired people, disposable income. With nothing else to do,
telling people mystery trip because they don't know where they are. Anyway.
They don't know where they're going.
They don't know where they're going. But I think that's a wonderful, you know,
where they're going.
That's a good thing. But we could take advantage still of being a drive-through as people got ahead. You know, once you're here, you know, when you go out and there's like 500 miles to the next gas station.
Yeah.
Now, I think that would be something cool for the city. Is like, once you hit Nacogdoches, where are you going? Because it's just dark as hell out 59, and where's the next hotel? I don't know.
All right, so what are our objectives?
All right, increase days tonight. Mm-hmm. We definitely want to target them. We want to target high-end bus tours.
Well, what you want to do is grow your tour business. Targeting appropriate group operators is a strategy.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Grow overnight tour business.
Absolutely.
No, that's number one is to increase days tonight, and the other one's grow tour business.
I don't think it's any more complicated than that. We want more of these people coming and spending the night.
Mm-hmm. You know, and we have a winery now and a distillery now.
Exactly. And so that's where I'm thinking maybe there's an objective here that says something about, kind of like your third bullet, integrate brand identity. We want to make sure that we're being specific about the attractions that these people should be coming here to see. Now that's a strategy to me rather than an objective.
Okay, well, why those first two are the objectives?
I don't think it's any more complicated than that.
No.
Did you say increase days, like day trips to overnight trips?
I put increase days tonight because I think of that song. Wasted days and wasted, and then.
Well, and if there's a way to document that you've converted day trips to overnights, then that's, That's a valid objective.
Right.
Or that you increase the number of overnight tours versus day tours.
Okay. So increasing days to nights is one measurable, and then the other is
tour business.
Yeah.
And then the end of that is
strategy we've had this year.
And then it all comes down to how are you going to do that? And that's where your strategy, that's the plan. Are we to sports?
We're to sports, and Shirley couldn't be here, but one of the things that we've realized is sports will continue to be something that grows, but until we get lights here, we're kind of at the mercy of it.
Okay, so what are so for this year, what are our objectives when it comes to sports? You can't say we're going to attract X number of tournaments because you know that can't happen, probably.
No.
Okay. So what's a realistic objective to get us moving forward in this segment?
I think we need to do more PR. We need to have more campaigns.
But what are we selling if we don't have the facilities?
Well, I mean, that's nothing but positioning. It's just like the for Duncan before it opens.
Well, do we have any across the sports? Do we have any facility? The soccer fields, they have lights. Or putting lights out at Dempsey's Field up there.
I don't think we have anything that's.
There's some light fields.
Yeah, they're going to be able to play out there once the softball fields get up. But after that meeting, what Wally's doing on campus. I mean, there might be some increase with SFA, but that doesn't have anything to do with us.
So we might do a smaller regional thing, but
you can't do anything without lights, because here's the thing. If they can turn around and go home, they're going to.
Yeah.
Unless we can have games at 8 o'clock at night, they're not going to spend the night. That's the way it rolls.
So is the objective to get lights at the field?
Well, and they're coming. It's just a matter of time. Is it going to be this year, according to Brian? No. Brian Bray. But it's happening. It's in the works. And like we were talking about at that other field where I think there were lights, they found out there's some live underground wire that if you stepped on it, you'd be fried.
So if we're going to get the lights...
That's an element of support.
There you go.
If that's funded, is it funded or is it...
It is funded.
Okay. Then if we're going to get lights in 2018, let's say, then our objective needs to start going after these tournaments
for that year.
Yes.
And schedule them in 2018.
Right.
Yeah.
Just like with the hotel, you have some lead time here. So if you do that.
Well, the difference is we know it's going to open. Do we know we're getting lights?
We definitely know we're getting lights.
Okay. Then let's move our objective forward to that.
To getting lights?
To getting these tournaments in 2018.
Oh, yeah.
And what that means, if it's a measurable objective, to
RFPs.
Because that's the same thing with admissions.
Yes. Bingo.
You put in the bids, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry about that.
And you offer the guys who put on these tournaments.
Absolutely.
You go to them and go, here's what we can do for you.
Okay.
This is how we can make your tournament great. This is what we're willing to give. And generally, there's an incentive. There's a 5% or 10% kickback that these guys get for doing these tournaments. But they organize them and bring all these people to your community.
Right. Now, there's one group that I just got an email from yesterday, and I did send it to Shirley. It is the disc golf folks. So now that we're in the loop, they want us to, there's an incentive. They want a little something from us. But it's not unheard of, and it's a good proposal, and we could definitely do that one. The cool thing with that is since it's already turnkey and they're coming, what they're looking for, other than a little bit of cash, is volunteers, which is where Shirley steps in and says, I can get that from the university.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Last year, it was bribery from these guys. We'll pay you or we'll give you food if you volunteer, which I think shouldn't be the case. They should just come. I think it was a golf team. But the neat thing is that if we could be more of service, they can duplicate that again in the fall, and that's the key. That's another tournament.
We had this conversation at the last meeting, I think, when Brian was here, about the fact that you've got to commit some serious dollars to get some of these tournaments to come here. So to me, another objective may be, rather than increasing the visibility of the Nacogdoches Sports Advisory Council, is lining up. So this is where the partnership thing really makes sense to me, because if these tournaments are coming to town and they need $25,000 up front to bring 200 people to town for 3 days, well, those people are going to be in the restaurants. Those people are going to be in the shops. Those people are going to be. That's where our community partners come in. Let's all kick in a little bit and make this happen. So maybe instead of increasing the visibility of Sports Advisory Council, we need to shift to developing some kind of a tangible mechanism to get these bids to make some viable bids for these tournaments. Because the CVB is not going to be able to put that money out there.
And frankly, we're not that efficient. Yeah, we've got community partners that'll participate.
Yes.
And I love the idea of the disc golf. I assume we are exploring non-traditional sporting events.
Like stepping on live wires.
Yeah. Bovine bingo, stuff like that.
Yeah.
What is it?
Bovine bingo. Hey, but if people pay to come stay here for a week.
All right. As long as I don't have to participate. Yep. Is that sport or is that gambling? That's a very leisurely activity, I think.
Well, the disc golf, I mean, that might be a market. If we got a good relationship with them, they might come here every year, just have it set up.
We'll make this the home of disc golf.
I think our fields and with the combo of Lufkin.
Well, you've got 216 people coming for 3 days. Yeah. Well, play, not coming, but play. So I don't mind if those are from out of town.
That's good. Okay. Quick question though. If we go through this, and do y'all think on these strategies, do we really have to break it down, advertising, print, things like that, or should we just have our strategies?
I think that the latter.
Okay, I agree. Because some of them can be combined.
Then because you have your strategy, and then if someone asks, what is involved in that strategy? You go advertising, print.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Right. That kind of fits with it.
Okay. Absolutely.
And then also, Mark, do you feel then our the word benchmark should be measured? Or should it be benchmark?
That was my question that's been going through my mind.
Should we just call it measurements? Or
either way.
Measurables.
Okay. Measurable. Yeah.
I like measurable.
Of course, the terminology that we use is objective method rather than strategy, and then criteria for success.
Whatever city council and the public can understand.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, then maybe I should.
And I think objective strategies and measures are benchmarks either way.
All right. Yeah.
But so let's keep our measures of success.
No, just measures.
But let's know, even though there's a lot of stuff going on, I think you guys are doing great work. But ultimately, what it comes down to is we have one mission, and that's to
exactly.
And so let's not make it more complicated than that.
Okay, I can tell you from that annual report I saw, she used a lot of Texas industry numbers that were for us reported out of Austin. And there was no economic impact. There was just a list of the groups, a list of things that came.
What
so there was
this?
Never measures. This was that annual report thing I found.
Oh, from our old days? Yeah, we don't want to. There's no reason to think of any of that as.
Yeah. So I wasn't really sure.
Okay, so we're doing under each segment objectives.
Strategies,
but not breaking down advertising because of that.
Unless you think there's a really good reason to
strategies.
Do that. Yeah.
And not all of these either. Well, shorter objectives, however many strategies we need, and then our measures.
Yep. As long as we've got measurable objectives that support our mission, we're good.
Okay.
But that's the one thing I want to add to this, our mission. That's point number one.
It is in here.
All right, because that's the other piece.
It also mission, has this great strategy. Letter by Mark Berger.
Yeah, I rewrote it.
What's that?
I liked your letter, but I wrote it.
You need to read your letter.
Yeah, it might have a little bleeding heart in there, I'm not sure.
We talked about the, not forget what it's called, either in addition to the letter.
The summary.
Yes.
And I think the summary is the quarterly report he's talking about, and so we might want to do that.
I don't need it.
We might want to do that.
Go into a summary.
Because the marketing plan is separate from the summary. The summary needs to go with the quarterly reports. Does that make sense? So you have to present, we're presenting this as separate from our quarterly report. The summation is in the quarterly report.
Okay. So we're not going to do that.
No.
Okay. Any other business? And it's 9:45 and we're going to adjourn.
Thank you.
Good, Sherry.